Hi, Ben. Great to have you here to talk about all things in Gen AI with Box and AWS. Just to warm up, can you tell us about Box and your role at the company?
Sure. At Box, our job, our whole world is around what you would call content or unstructured data. So we have 100,000 plus enterprise customers, and they store with us hundreds of billions, trillions of files, of content, of sort of the some of the most valuable pieces of data in their organization. We've been around for a while, and we really focus on sort of the idea of enterprise-grade content solutions across the board of everything you'd ever want to do with content. I'm Ben Kuss. I'm the Chief Technology Officer, and my job is many things, but one of the key things to talk about today is I'm leading our AI initiatives around how we can use AI on top of all this content.
Oh, that's exciting. Talking about AI, Box and AWS is partnering to do more and more in this space. But before we double click into that, can you share a little bit about your journey with Gen AI? How has it been so far?
Sure. So it's been certainly interesting. So in general, with when you have something like content, for us, we're always interested in the latest technologies that let us handle sort of at scale, like for our customers, new capabilities that would let them kind of get more. So in general, for most of our customers, like 90% of the data they have is like this unstructured data in the form of PowerPoints and PDFs and docs and videos and audio files and so on. And so many companies consider this some of their most valuable information, but it kind of sometimes gets, it's difficult to manage in terms of getting the information you need when you want it, because historically what you had to do is have a human sit down and kind of read through it, right? If you wanted to know about some information in a document, you read it. If you want to know about a video, you watch it, like, and then that kind of stuff. So whereas there's been this like giant data revolution with structured data, like stuff in databases, there wasn't necessarily the same revolution that happened with unstructured data. And so we've been very interested in the history of AI around using techniques to let us kind of gather insights. And for many years, we've done that. We've used some AWS technologies, things like Textract, things like some of your SageMaker, like machine learning capabilities to kind of understand the data. But to be honest, for many years, it was kind of, you know, work well on bits and pieces of data, but there's such a wide variety of content, both in the type and the reason for it, that it was, you never kind of had anything that really sort of was like a brand new set of technologies that would kind of change the way that people interacted with this type of content. But with Generative AI came out, and in particular, when it kind of got to the level of sort of like what you would call like maybe 2 years ago, like GPT-3.0 level kind of style, that's when really the capabilities of being able to like actually have what you might consider to be like an AI assistant who could go through and almost basically read the data or understand it the way that humans would, and then basically help you both find, understand, extract insights from your data. And this is what, when we talk to our enterprise customers, they're very excited about, because basically this huge corpus of very useful information suddenly becomes more useful because it no longer requires, you know, again, a person to do every little piece of it. You can have the technology kind of really assist you.
That's awesome. Can you share a little bit about like how the AI assistant, the Box AI assistant, what are the benefits I as a customer get because of generative AI?
Yeah, so there's kind of there's a whole variety of capabilities that AI can bring, but two of the most important that our customers tell us about is this idea of being able to sort of ask questions around a corpus of data and kind of get responses. So imagine that you had there's plenty of like examples and content, but I'll just pick one. Is imagine you have like a sales portal of information of like your salesperson, your job is to kind of understand, you know, get trained on all this data, and your job is to kind of like sell to customers. And so imagine, but like many of our customers have complex products of all types, all industries and so on. And so you might go and say like, so the customer asks you a question like, oh, how does this thing work? Or what is this certification, or what, like something that is typically complex, domain specific, company specific type of question. So, you know, a lot of times historically, oh, let me get back to you. Let me check with sales engineer. But now with the idea of something like the feature of like what we call multi-document QA, or we have a feature called Hubs AI, using the power of generative AI and these models, you can actually ask your, this corpus of content can basically ask an assistant to look through it for you and get an answer in real time. So you can imagine like your customer asks a question and you can ask it, and then it comes back to you and says, well, here's the information. And it looked it up in the information that you, that was available, you know, that your team makes, that your product marketing or your engineers, they put the information in here in the different forms of different sort of modalities. And then the AI can kind of synthesize it all and give you not, here's a document to read to answer this question, but here's the answer that I've gathered from all this information. So this is something that uses retrieval augmented generation, and it uses sort of the underlying technology, AI tech, to be able to get you this data. And this is one really critical thing that we think is going to be sort of not only like a big difference from people, how people used to use their content, but just incredibly useful.
Oh.
That, and the second sort of key use case for us is this idea of sometimes you have a lot of data that has like a structured element to it. Typically things like business process documents, like contracts or invoices or policies, or this kind of whole corpus of data that has like the idea of like, you know, the structure and labels and metadata associated with it. And so this is something that in the past we've used a lot of the sort of the older school machine learning techniques to be able to like kind of have a model train to do one thing. But with the power of generative AI, it can kind of label and structure data in many different ways. So you can imagine you have a series of this data and you have AI go through and basically mark it. And it'd be like, let's say you had some really critical standard operating procedures or contracts. So the AI can go through, read it, and then just pull out the key info that your teams need to be able to sort of manage that kind of data. So generative AI is excellent at that kind of things.
You talked about then what benefits customers get out of this. And now double clicking and seeing how we are you're able to get it done. This is where I know both Box and AWS are partnering deeper with things like Bedrock and so forth. Can you maybe give a quick summary on now how, what AWS technologies you use along with your own backend architecture so that others can actually understand that more?
Yeah, absolutely. So we've been an AWS partner for a very long time. I think, I don't know if we were one of the first enterprise class SaaS companies, but I would imagine one of the early ones for, I think must be over 15 years now, where Box used AWS for everything, like not even specific to AI. But then within the world of AI, the AWS Bedrock is pretty critical for us because for a bunch of reasons. So when you kind of look at technology wise and you think about what it takes to give those kind of use cases mentioned, like there's kind of two important things. One is quality, and then one is trust. And so if I put trust first for a moment, like our enterprise customers are very aware that there are not only new capabilities with AI, but new concerns. And they are not going to basically just say, oh, we're going to do AI, unless they very much understand and trust all levels of what it means to do AI. And it includes looking at the vendors who provide the AI capabilities. And so, I mean, I was just on the phone with a customer yesterday who was Fortune 100, and they said, I'm not going to use a new AI vendor because I'm worried. I need a company that has the history that I can trust, that I know if I'm using it on some of my most critical, most sensitive data, that I'm going to trust that they not only are trustworthy, but then they also have the background of the security, the compliance, the certifications to be able to make sure that the data is safe and secure. And so for us, for AWS, many of our customers, in fact, or maybe all of them, like trust AWS because they know they have history. They have sort of seen that the AWS is one of the most trustworthy companies in the enterprise world because of your long history and your long set of services. And so as a prerequisite to just getting any benefit of AI, you have to have that trust relationship. So we work with AWS to provide those models directly. And then our customers say, well, are your data stored in Box, often in AWS? And then also the AI is done through AWS hosted models. And therefore they see the whole end-to-end stack of trust. And then they're able to then approve usage after we kind of walk through all of the key capabilities and sort of safety precautions that are built in. And then the second is on quality. So like, it's kind of like, you know, we always talk about these assistants for AI and, I have an assistant for content reading through stuff. But your assistant has to be pretty good, right? And so the quality of the model matters a lot. And of course, with something like Bedrock, you guys have some of the best models available. I mean, I'll highlight like the one that is the top of most leaderboards, which is Anthropic's 3.5 Sonnet. And for us, in the kind of varied and complex use cases we have, we find that works really well. Like from the perspective of, you can, if you're a lawyer and you have questions about a bunch of contracts, or if you're a If you're an engineer and you have questions about like a bunch of like critical like product information that you have or complex technical documents, it does a great job of just understanding it, understanding what you're asking, and then being able to pull the data together. And if you don't have that, then you know, sort of this AI, these AI capabilities don't really work. They don't make sense. People just don't really use them. So the quality of this overall is where we see Bedrock providing some of the best technologies that we've ever come across.
I love that how you distill it into trust and quality are the two anchors on how you're thinking about your AI assistant and the platform choices. And also talked about how quality comes from having access to best-in-class models and a diverse set as well. It totally makes sense. I'll just touch on two more things. Where do you plan to go next with generative AI? I know it's a hard question because this space evolves so rapidly, but I'm always fascinated by how people think through on the future on where they want to take it.
So we do have a principle of the moment. So I'm going to give you my first answer, and then I'll give you sort of the second future looking one. So the first answer is one thing that we are very cautious about is that we want to make sure that everything that we release works well, works safely, works at enterprise grade. And it goes back to this idea of quality and this idea of being able to provide some of the fundamentals of it actually works. And I think in the world of generative AI, this maybe in the beginning, it kind of threw some people off, is that like normally when you develop software, it takes you like a long time to get to a point where something's almost done. It works pretty well. And then you kind of finish it off and you know, release that GA product. And especially in an enterprise sort of context where we have, you know, like they expect things to work well. And I think sometimes smaller companies, sometimes maybe even bigger companies, like they, when they had AI working like pretty well, they like kind of were like, oh, okay, like I'm probably almost done. But I think what you learn with generative AI is it takes a long time to go from almost done to working really well in all cases. So this is the world of like getting the better models, getting the different techniques to make it work well. So we're just, one important question is we want to provide all the capabilities mentioned and we want to do it really well. So we're going to continue to invest in it. So a new model comes out, our first thought is not necessarily what can we do that's new and different. We say, how can we use it to continue to improve on our fundamental value proposition of Box AI overall? Okay, so I'll say that part. And the new models have gone so great. Like again, I'll highlight the AWS's Anthropic models, very trustworthy, very safe, and also quite wonderful quality. Now, on the other side, some of the new capabilities that we're interested in is around things like multimodality. Remember, like in our world, like although text content is a big part of it in fundamental, you know, it's just naturally people create that. Being able to see and understand the idea of text next to images, you know, just think about how we like, you know, like consume PowerPoint or PDFs. There's often like a lot of images, charts, information, and tables in different forms. And so being able to understand that together in a multimodal way is critical. Our customers have a lot of images, they have a lot of videos and audio. And so being able to have the AI not just help you answer questions by reading the text, but by sort of perceiving it as we as humans do. And this is where we think is very valuable. So imagine that example I gave around, you know, the sales material where it was not only did it answer your question, but it also highlighted like, you know, minute four of this recording tells you about this, and this is what they answered. And here's a chart that shows us the progress. And that kind of thing is, we think, like kind of pushing forward the boundaries of, and even ways that people haven't fully, like most people have experienced generative AI and like kind of like a form of chatting with some sort of AI model. I don't know if they've all experienced the idea of having to understand this kind of multimodal data. And we think that is really critical for the future.
One final question to all fellow CTOs and CIOs and their leaders who are watching. What's your advice to them as they embark on their Gen AI journey?
As you mentioned, like it's evolving very rapidly and in different, like depending on how you've kind of experienced this trend, like a lot of people went and they saw and they experienced it and they tried it internally, like, oh, let's use this model for this purpose. Some of them said, this is wonderful, and we started to move forward. Other people said, I didn't quite get what we wanted. And maybe they then put that project on hold, or they sort of like thought, well, I'll revisit. So my advice is to revisit and to try things often and try it again. Like again, to the point, like if you have experienced something that was on an older model, like of any of the AI models, like I bet you AWS Anthropic 3.5 Sonnet is going to be way better. It's going to blow your mind about how good of the quality is. like arguably these models are becoming smarter than even like really well-trained people. And so then when you combine that with like retrieval augmented generation and your company's data, like you start to see these really kind of amazing things. And so if you haven't tried it and tried it lately, then you might be missing out on some of the big benefits. Like even 3 months ago or 6 months ago, it was just a different story in terms of what the models were capable of. So my advice would be to try it, see how it works, and then continue to try it, especially when you hear about these new evolutions that are happening in the marketplace.
Oh, that totally makes sense. Be on a constant experimentation mode and be curious about it so that you know how you can make things better and better on a daily basis is a great advice as well. With that, Ben, again, it's amazing to work together to build some great technologies over the years, as you pointed out, let alone in generative AI as well. Thanks again for all the amazing partnership and really looking forward to seeing how our mutual customers are innovating together on what we have built as well.
Thanks for having me.